Now the next sutta is 4.5.50. This is also quite an important sutta. Monks, there are these four stains of moon and sun, stained by which stains moon and sun burn not, shine not, blaze not. What are the four? Cloud, monks, is a stain of moon and sun. Fog, smoke and dust. Rahu, monks, is a stain of moon and sun, stain by which moon and sun burn not, shine not, blaze not. These are the four stains. I'll just stop here for a while. Here the Buddha is saying there are four things which block the moon and the sun from shining very brightly. What are the four? The first one is cloud. If there's too much cloud, it will block the sun or the moon. The second one is fog. Third one is smoke and dust, like in KL city. Now with the all this smoke and dust around. And then Rahu. Who is Rahu? Rahu is one of the Asura kings, and he's supposed to be one of the largest devas, very huge Asura king. And sometimes there's a drawing of Rahu trying to swallow the moon. It shows how big Rahu is. So because Rahu is so big, when it goes in front of the moon, it can block the moon from our sight. So it seems. So the Buddha continued, just so, monks, there are four stains of recluses and Brahmins, stained by which some recluses and Brahmins burn not, shine not, blaze not. What for? Monks, there are some recluses and Brahmins who drink fermented liquor, who drink liquor distilled, who abstain not from liquor fermented and distilled. This, monks, is the first fault of recluses and Brahmins, stained by which some recluses and Brahmins burn not, shine not, blaze not. Monks, there are some recluses and Brahmins who are given to things sexual, who abstain not from things sexual. This, monks, is the second stain of recluses and Brahmins, stain by which some recluses and Brahmins burn not, shine not, blaze not. Monks, there are some recluses and Brahmins who take gold and silver, which is actually money, during the Buddha's time, money was gold and silver. Who take gold and silver, who abstain not from accepting gold and silver. This, monks, is the third stain by which some recluses and Brahmins burn not, shine not, blaze not. Monks, there are some recluses and Brahmins who live by a wrong means of living, who abstain not from a wrong livelihood. This, monks, is the fourth stain of recluses and Brahmins, stain by which some recluses and Brahmins burn not, shine not, blaze not. This is a kind of sutta which is quite critical of certain monks. It is quite won't be a very popular sutta with some monks. The first one, the Buddha is saying that monks should not take liquor, should not take fermented liquor. There are some monks who use the excuse that liquor is like a medicine, and they take liquor, and this because of that, they would stain their monkhood. They would not be a proper monk. They would not blaze and shine like the sun and the moon. And the second one is to indulge in sexual intercourse. Some monks, they do this kind of thing secretly. And so they are basically no more a monk, because this is one of those things which constitute the major precept, the most heavy offense for a monk, to engage in sexual intercourse, makes a monk no more a monk, even though he wears the robe. The third one is not one of the major precepts, accepting money. But the Buddha did not want monks to accept money because it gives a very bad impression. And then because if monks accept money nowadays, what happens is there's a lot of false, fake monks. They go to the marketplace, they stand around wearing the robe and trying to collect money instead of trying to collect food. And sometimes they even come out at night. You hear them going to Pasar Malam, those night stalls, and trying to collect money. So it is all because some monks accept money directly. So it is not a good practice. It is the Buddha advised monks not to accept money directly, so this precept against money is not considered a major precept lah. Some because sometimes when a monk travels, when a monk has to travel outstation, sometimes he has no choice but to carry some money if he goes overseas lah. So, coming back to this precept against money, the precept against money, the main point that the Buddha does not like, the reason why Buddha does not want monks to, not so much to accept money, but to use money. Because if a monk uses money to buy the things that he wants to buy, then the Buddha says he can indulge in the sense pleasures. He can buy things which he wants to use to enjoy. So that is the main precept. It's not so much that a monk cannot touch money, because it is allowed in the Vinaya for a monk to touch money sometimes when it is necessary. For example, if lay people come to the monastery and they drop some money, it is allowed for a monk to pick up the money and put it in a corner so that to give it to the layperson another day. But it is not allowed for a monk to pick up money in the streets. You see some money drop, $10 on the street. It's not allowed for a monk to pick it up. Only inside the monastery or in a lay supporter's house. Suppose he goes to a lay supporter's house for dana. And then after that, the lay supporter has to go out. So the lay supporter maybe left a ring on the table or something, and then the monk is afraid that somebody may come and pick up this ring. It's allowed for the monk to take up that ring, a gold ring or money or whatever, and put it aside, safekeeping, to return it to the lay supporter. So, as I said, it is not a major precept. So sometimes monks relax the rule when they think that it's necessary. For example, if a monk travels overseas, he might have to pay airport tax. So it's necessary to carry some money with him. But if the monk were to go around the shops shopping like a lay person, it creates a very bad image to the public. Because especially you see, people have a lot of respect for Theravada monks generally, because the Theravada monks are more strict with the Vinaya, and people bow down to a monk because the monk upholds the precept. So that's why it is stated somewhere that the Vinaya is the lifeblood of the sasana. Without the precepts, the sasana cannot survive long. So then the last one is wrong livelihood. Wrong livelihood for a monk means to get a living through wrong means. For example, to engage in fortune telling, to make predictions, to go and do feng shui, this geomancy. Can tell a lay person how to arrange the house, where to put the door and how to alter the door and all these things. Even to act as a doctor, is not allowed for a monk unless it is to close supporters. Supporters who have faith in the monk, because if a monk were to act like a doctor, sometimes something might go wrong. And if people don't have enough faith in that monk, then they will spread a lot of bad things about the monk, which in turn affects the sasana, affects the religion. That's why the Buddha said, generally, monks are not allowed to act as doctors also. You notice in the suttas that the Buddha, even though he had psychic power, he did not go around healing people. He did not go around raising the dead. Because he understood that things work according to karma, And unless you understand the working of karma, there's no point to obstruct karma. Even if you are able to obstruct karma for a time, for a short time, karma has to work its way, you know. You have to pay for the karma. If not now, another time. That's why you find sometimes some people, they have problems, they go to some medicine man or to somebody or other trying to get a cure, and sometimes they do get a temporary cure. Later, that sickness comes back again, because sometimes the sickness is due to karma. So the next sutta is 4.6.51. The Buddha said, "Monks, there are these four floods of merit, floods of things profitable, bringing happiness, giving the best things, whose fruit is happiness, leading to the heaven world, leading to what is dear, delightful and pleasant, to profit and happiness. What are the four? To him, monks, who is the giver of a robe, using which a monk is able to attain and abide in unbounded concentration of mind. To him comes a flood of merit, a flood of things profitable, bringing happiness. To him, monks, who is the giver of alms food, using which a monk is able to attain and abide in unbounded concentration of mind. To him comes a flood of merit, a flood of things profitable, bringing happiness. To him, monks, who is the giver of lodging, using which a monk is able to attain and abide in unbounded concentration of mind. To him comes a flood of merit, a flood of things profitable, bringing happiness. To him, monks, who is the giver of requisites and medicines for use in sickness, using which a monk is able to attain and abide in unbounded concentration of mind. To him comes a flood of merit, a flood of things profitable, bringing happiness, giving the best things, whose fruit is happiness, leading to the heaven world, leading to what is dear, delightful and pleasant, to profit and happiness. These monks are the four floods of merit, floods of things profitable. Moreover, monks, if an Aryan disciple be possessed of these four floods of merit, floods of things profitable, it is no easy thing to take the measure of his merit, so as to say, such and such is the extent of the flood of merit, and so forth. No, it is to be reckoned as an incalculable, immeasurable, mighty mass of merit. Just as, monks, it is no easy thing to take the measure of the water in the mighty ocean, so as to say, so many gallons of water, so many hundreds, so many thousands, so many hundreds of thousands of gallons of water. No, it is to be reckoned as an incalculable, immeasurable, mighty mass of merit. So in this sutta, the Buddha is saying, if you give the requisites to a monk, and the monk uses that the requisite so that he can practice, and he attains unbounded concentration of mind, and then you as a supporter will get a flood of merit which is so great that it is immeasurable. How is it the Buddha is talking about a monk getting unbounded concentration of mind? Why doesn't the Buddha say wisdom? Because unbounded concentration of mind leads to wisdom. That is what is implied here. The Buddha is not saying that a person gets wisdom straight away, because the precondition for wisdom is unbounded concentration, deep concentration of mind. That's why concentration is always stressed by the Buddha. Elsewhere, later on we'll see some other sutta where the Buddha said that the condition for wisdom is this deep concentration. Now we come to 4.6.55. On a certain occasion, the Exalted One was staying among the Baga near Crocodile Haunt at Besakala Grove in Antelope Park. Now in the morning, the Exalted One robed himself, and taking outer robe and bowl, set out for the dwelling of the house father, Nakula's father. On coming there, he sat down on a seat made ready. Then the house father, Nakula's father, and the housewife, Nakula's mother, came to see the Exalted One, and on coming to him, paid homage, and sat down at one side. So seated, the house father, Nakula's father, said this to the exalted one. Lord, ever since the housewife, Nakula's mother, Nakula Mata, was brought home to me when a mere lad, she being then a mere girl, I am not conscious of having transgressed against her, even in thought, much less in person. Lord, we do desire to behold each other, not only in this very life, but also in the life to come. Then the housewife, Nakula Mata, said this to the exalted one. Lord, ever since I, a mere girl, was led home to the house father, Nakula Pita, when I was a mere lad, I am not conscious of having transgressed against him, even in thought, much less in person. Lord, we do desire to behold each other, not only in this very life, but also in the life to come. Then the Buddha said, herein householders, if both wife and husband desire to behold each other, both in this very life and in the life to come, and both are matched in faith, matched in virtue, matched in generosity, matched in wisdom, then do they behold each other in this very life and in the life to come. This is an interesting sutta for a lot of people. These two persons, Nakula Mata and Nakula Pita, they were supposed to have been the Buddha's parents for many, many lifetimes in the past. And they were a very perfect couple. Until very old, they were still very much in love with each other. And they say that even from the moment they saw each other, beheld each other until very late in life, they never thought anything bad against the other person, never had any anger against the other. So they wanted to meet again in the next life. And the Buddha said, if you want to meet each other in the next life, you both must have the same, four things must be the same. First one is faith. Second one is virtue. Third is generosity. Fourth is wisdom. In other words, you have the same faith. You have the same beliefs, the same religion. The second one, you are equally matched in virtue. That means you are equally virtuous or equally evil. Third one is generosity. You are equally generous or equally selfish. And then the fourth one is wisdom, equally wise or equally foolish. Then with these four qualities, you'll meet again and again. So from here, you can imagine if you want to, you want the members of your family, if you love them, you want them to meet, to be with you again, you must teach them to have these four things, the same with you. So if you want to meet your children, you must teach them to follow the same religion, to have the same faith, in the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, and then to be as virtuous as you, to keep the precepts just like you, to be generous just like you, and to have wisdom just like you. So it is important, as this sutta shows, that if we love those people we love, we must teach them to walk the same path as us, and then we can meet them again and again. Then the next sutta is 4.6.57. On a certain occasion, the Exalted One was staying among the Kolians at a township of the Kolians called Sajanela. Then the Exalted One in the morning, robing himself and taking outer robe and bowl, approached the dwelling of Supavasa of the Kolians, and on reaching it sat down on a seat made ready. Then Supavasa of the Kolians, with her own hand, satisfied and served the Exalted One with choice food, both hard and soft. On seeing that the Exalted One had eaten his fill and had washed both hand and bowl, Supavasa of the Kolians sat down at one side. As she sat thus, the Exalted One said this to Supavasa of the Kolians. Supavasa, the Aryan woman disciple who gives food, gives four things to the receiver thereof. What for? She gives life, she gives beauty, she gives happiness, she gives strength. Moreover, giving life, she is a partaker of life, be it deva or human. Giving beauty, she is a partaker of beauty, be it deva or human. Giving happiness, giving strength, she is a partaker of it, be it as deva or human. Yes, Supavasa, the Aryan woman disciple who gives food gives these four things to the receiver thereof. This short sutta can see during the Buddha's time, after the lay people gave a meal to the monks, generally they gave a very short talk. Like in this, the Buddha only said a few lines, and as a thanksgiving. And later, maybe perhaps, you know, for a monk to give a short discourse every time he has a meal, is after some time he runs out of ideas what to talk. So from there, it's understandable how later monks started chanting. Because chanting would be easier. You chant the same chant again and again every day, instead of having to think of something to talk. And then these four qualities, if we give food to the monk, the Buddha said, we give four things. The first one is life. These four things in Pali is called Ayu, Vano, Sukang, Balang. Sometimes you hear us do the chant. You can hear us chant Ayu, Vano, Sukang, Balang. Ayu is life. Because when you give food to a monk, it sustains his life so he can live longer. Second one, it gives beauty, because when he has food, especially good food, the body looks better. The body is more beautiful looking. And then the third one is happiness. You give food to a monk, he's happy. And then the fourth one, it gives him strength. The body, he takes some good food and the body becomes strong. So in the same way, the Buddha said, when you give these four things to a monk, you also will receive it. And you will receive it either in the human form or the deva form, or whatever place you are reborn, you would get these four things back. So whenever we give food, these four things we give, and so it comes back to us very naturally. Now the next sutta is 4.6.60. Now the house father, Anatha Pindika, came to visit the Exalted One, paid respect, etc. As he sat at one side, the Exalted One said this to him, "House father, possessed of four things, the Aryan disciple has entered on the householder's path of duty, a path which brings good repute and leads to the heaven world. What are the four?" "Herein, house father, the Aryan disciple waits upon the order of monks, the Sangha of monks. He waits upon the Sangha of monks with the offer of a robe, alms, food, lodging, requisites, and medicines for use in sickness. These are the four things." Here the Buddha is saying that a Buddhist disciple has a householder's duty to look after the monk and supply the monk with the four requisites. The first one is a robe, second one is alms food, third one is lodging, and the fourth one is requisites and medicine for use in sickness. So if a lay person serves the Sangha, waits upon the Sangha with these four things, he is doing his or her duty, and he will get the reward. The Buddha said, a path which brings good repute and leads to the heaven world. So if you do this householder's duty to the Sangha, it will bring a lot of merit, especially if you are virtuous and the monk is virtuous also. Now the next sutta is 4.7.61. Now the house father, Anatha Pindika, came to visit the Exalted One. As he sat at one side, the Exalted One said this to him, "House father, there are these four conditions, desirable, dear, delightful, hard to win in the world. What for?" "The wish, oh, may wealth by lawful means come to me. This is the first condition." Wealth being gotten by lawful means, may good reputation attend me along with my kinsmen and teachers. This is the second condition. Wealth being gotten by lawful means and good reputation being gotten by me along with my kinsmen and teachers, may I live long and reach a great age. This is the third condition. Then wealth being gotten and good reputation and long life when body breaks up, when body breaks up on the other side of death, may I attain the happy bond, the heaven world. This is the fourth condition. These house father are the four conditions which is desirable, dear, delightful, hard to win in the world. I'll just stop here for a while. These are the four things that lay people normally like, they wish for. The first one, that you may get a lot of wealth by lawful means. Not by unlawful means, because that will attain a lot of, that will entail a lot of problems later, but to get a lot of wealth by lawful means. The second one, may you wish that you would have a good reputation. The third one, may you live long. The fourth one, may you have a good rebirth. These are the four things that most people normally like. And then the Buddha said, now house father, to the winning of these four conditions, four other conditions conduce. What four? Perfection of faith, perfection of virtue, perfection of generosity, and perfection of wisdom. And what, house father, is the perfection of faith? Herein the Aryan disciple is faithful. He has faith in the enlightenment of the Tathagata thus. He it is, exalted one, Arhan, Sammasambuddha, and so forth. A Buddha is the exalted one. This house father is called perfection of faith. And what is perfection of virtue? Herein the Aryan disciple abstains from killing, from stealing, from committing adultery, from lying, from drinking fermented liquor, which causes sloth. This is called perfection of virtue. And what is perfection of generosity? Herein the Aryan disciple lives at home with heart free from the taint of stinginess. He is open-handed, pure-handed, delighting in self-surrender, one to ask a favor from, who delights in dispensing charitable gifts. This house father is called perfection of generosity. And what is perfection of wisdom? House father, living with his heart overcome by coveting and wrongful desire, one does what he should not, fails to do what he should, so doing, so failing to do, he falls from good report and happiness. Living with his heart overcome by malice, by sloth and torpor, by restlessness and worry, by doubt unwavering, he does what he should not, fails to do what he should, so doing, so failing to do, he falls from good report and happiness. Now, house father, that Aryan disciple, knowing coveting and wrong desire to be a defilement of the mind, casts out the mind's defilement of coveting and wrong desire, casts out the mind's defilement of malice, sloth and torpor, restlessness and worry, doubt and wavering. Now, house father, in so far as the Aryan disciple, knowing coveting and the rest to be defilements of the mind, is one who has cast out these defilements, this Aryan disciple is called of great wisdom, of far spread wisdom, of clear range of vision, one perfect in wisdom. These four conditions, house father, conduce to the realization of the before said four conditions, which are desirable, dear, delightful, and hard to win in the world. I'll just stop here for a while to recapitulate the four factors. The Buddha said, if we want those earlier things which are desirable, there are four things that we should cultivate. The first one is faith, to have faith in the Buddha. The second one is to have virtue, meaning to keep the precepts, the five precepts. Third one is to be generous, one who is open-handed, likes to give. The fourth one is perfection of wisdom. This perfection of wisdom is basically to abandon the five hindrances. To abandon the five hindrances means to get samadhi. So you see here is very clear that perfection of wisdom is to develop the mind, to have samadhi bhavana, so that the five hindrances are abandoned. And the five hindrances are abandoned, is mentioned elsewhere, when we get one-pointedness of mind, when the jhana is attained, and then that is the condition for wisdom. Now to continue. Now, House Father, that same Aryan disciple with the wealth acquired by energetic striving, amassed by strength of arm, won by sweat, lawfully gotten, is the doer of four deeds. What are the four? Herein, House Father, with the wealth acquired by energetic striving and so forth, the Aryan disciple makes himself happy and cheerful. He is a contriver of perfect happiness and makes his mother and father, his children and wife, his servants and workmen, his friends and comrades, cheerful and happy. He is a contriver of perfect happiness. This House Father is the first opportunity seized by him, turned to merit and fittingly made use of. Then again, House Father, the Aryan disciple with the wealth acquired by energetic striving, amassed by strength of arm, won by sweat, lawful and lawfully gotten. With that wealth, he makes himself secure against all misfortunes whatsoever, such as may happen by way of fire, water, the Raja, a robber, an ill-disposed person, or an expectant heir. He takes steps for his defense. He makes himself secure. This House Father is the second opportunity seized by him, turned to merit, and fittingly made use of. Again, House Father, with the wealth acquired by energetic striving, lawfully gotten, the Aryan disciple is a maker of the fivefold offering, namely to relatives, to guests, to departed ghosts, to the Raja and to the Devas. This is the third opportunity seized by him, turned to merit and fittingly made use of. Then again, House Father, with the wealth acquired by energetic striving, etc., the Aryan disciple offers a gift to all such recluses and Brahmins as abstain from sloth and negligence, who are bent on kindness and forbearance, who tame the oneself, calm the oneself, cool the oneself. To such, he offers a gift which has the highest results, a gift heavenly, resulting in happiness and leading to heaven. This is the fourth opportunity seized by him, turned to merit, and fittingly made use of. So, House Father, this same Aryan disciple, with the wealth acquired by energetic striving, lawfully gotten, etc., is a doer of these four deeds of merit. If the wealth of anyone be spent without these four deeds of merit, such wealth is called wealth that has failed to seize its opportunity, failed to win merit, unfittingly made use of. But House Father, if the wealth of anyone be spent on these four deeds of merit, then it is called wealth that has seized its opportunity, turned to merit, and is fittingly made use of. That's the end of the sutta. Now, this is a very interesting sutta for lay people, especially. First, the Buddha is telling us the four things which everybody wants. Then, secondly, the Buddha is saying what are the conditions that you must practice to attain what you want in the world. Then, the third set of things, is the Buddha is trying to tell us how to use your wealth when you have acquired wealth, because all the happiness that we get in the world is actually the use of our past merit, because of our past merit, now we have a good life. But if you keep on enjoying life, you are using up all your good karma. So it's very important to put back into your karma bank all the meritorious deeds. If you continue to do meritorious deeds, you are storing up the good karma in your karma bank. So the Buddha is telling us the first way to use your wealth in a skillful way so that you can get merit out of it is to make yourself happy. That means to enjoy life a bit and all those around you, your mother and father, wife and children, servants and workmen, friends and relatives, etc. You try to make all those around you, including yourself, a bit happy. Second one, you must guard yourself against misfortunes. For example, fire, water, these two maybe nowadays is buying insurance or something. And then the Raja, that means you have to be careful. In those days, the Raja could seize your property. So sometimes you have to be nice to the Raja, buy him a present now and then. And then the robber, you have to take steps so that your house is not robbed. Maybe get guards or get dogs or something. And even an expectant heir, if somebody wants to heir to your property, and some in those days they might kill that person and so that he can get the property. Then the third one is to make the fivefold offering to relatives, to guests, to the departed. Departed meaning you do some good deeds and you transfer merit to them. But it is mentioned elsewhere in some other sutta that they used to offer things to the departed and burn them. And then to the Raja, you have to offer to the Raja and to the Devas. Devas, like offering flowers, incense, etc. So if you do all these things, then you conserve your good karma so that you will have this, enjoy the fruits of your good karma again. It is mentioned elsewhere, there's another sutta where the Buddha said, if you want the things desirable in the world, they are not good to be got by prayers and vows. Later when we come to that sutta, I can explain more. So here, it's not by prayers and vows, but the cultivating four things, faith, virtue, generosity, and wisdom. And then always remember to use your money in a wise way so that it's not wasted. Use it so that you get the benefit of it by way of merit, etc.